One of the things I discovered when I first came into ethical culture, I came to this building here on 64th Street, which I had known for most of my life, listening to Algernon Black on QXR. But I discovered that this building was not alone in the movement, because in 1998 when I came in and listened to the platform, we had speakers from Westchester, from Bergen, and I think from St. Louis, from some of the ethical culture societies, and I realized that strengthens the ethical culture movement, having so many societies. And today, we are most fortunate to have Hugh Taft Morales as our speaker on the Tree of Knowledge, celebrating the roots of humanism. Hugh comes to us with a scholarly background on the roots of humanism. Born and raised in Connecticut, he graduated from Yale University and earned a master's in philosophy from the University of Kent at Canterbury. He taught philosophy and history for 25 years in Washington, D.C., after which he transitioned to the ethical culture leadership. He served on the board of the Washington Ethical Society from 2002 to 2006, the last year as president. He graduated from the Humanist Institute and was certified as an ethical culture leader by the American Ethical Union in 2010. Currently, he is the leader of two societies, of the Ethical Humanist Society of Philadelphia and the Baltimore Ethical Society. That's a commitment. He served as secretary of the National Leaders Council of the American Ethical Union and is editor of the AEU's Ethical Action Report. He lives in Tacoma Park, Maryland, with his wife, Maureen, who's with us this morning, a Latin American analyst for the Congressional Research Service. They have three adult children. Please welcome Hugh Taft Morales.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
How's this work?
Good.
All right, great.
It's working.
It's working. Thanks to Cheryl and to all of you and to your leaders. Being at two societies is an interesting thing. I don't get out very often, so coming up in the summer is one time I could do that. We went to a show last night, did the whole New York thing, so that was a lot of fun. At the Ethical Humanist Society in Philadelphia, every December, we put up this 12-foot artificial tree, and we welcome our friends from the Freethought Society, including its founder, Margaret Downey, to come hang laminated book covers that decorate the tree from all of our favorite humanist books. There may be Thomas Paine's The Age of Reason, or Elizabeth Cady Stanton's Woman's Bible, or some Margaret Sanger books, perhaps. And we do so in part because that tree was banned from the grounds of the Westchester County Courthouse because it was there for a number of years next to some traditional religious displays, a creche, and a Santa. And this, the tree of knowledge that we have in our building every December now honors openness and tolerance and the quest for wisdom. And it is there because we believe in promoting knowledge. We think it's a good thing. We include in the decorations traditional religious books as well. But despite that, some people of traditional faith see our tree of knowledge as an attack on religion. And this was the case when the tree was in its original location, which was, as I said, at the county courthouse grounds next to these displays of other religions. Some saw the tree so insulting and heretical that they vandalized it year after year. And instead of dealing with the vandals, the commissioners decided to ban the tree. So we welcomed it. We said there was room at the society, and so we welcomed it there. Now today, although it's related, I want to focus not on that particular artificial tree, but on the organic and growing, but metaphorical tree of knowledge represented by human wisdom captured in books. If you'll notice my tie my wife gave for me for today's talk, it's a tie from the Library of Congress with books all on it. Now, for centuries, this metaphorical tree of knowledge was nourished by those who wrote the books. It was tended by bookmakers. It was harvested by all the readers in the humanist tradition. And it blossomed in particular in the Renaissance and in the Enlightenment, and it's fundamental to humanism and to ethical culture. Now, ethical culture certainly was built on books. Volumes and volumes of them filled the homes of our founder, Felix Adler. His father, Samuel, was a rabbi and a scholar who said that his happiest hours were in his library. Books and reading are fundamental to the Jewish tradition that Samuel Adler came from. 12th century scholar Tibbon saw his personal library as his most precious gift to his son. He said in his will that it is, quote, his best companion and his best treasure. His advice to all of those following his tradition was to nurture your library like a living garden, helping it grow. He wrote, "Let your bookcases and your shelves be your gardens and your pleasure grounds. Pluck the fruit that grows therein, gather the roses, the spices, and the myrrh." It's a lovely image, I think. Now, Samuel Adler encouraged his son to spend time in this garden. Felix Adler read voraciously. He developed an encyclopedic mind, and he created this alternative to traditional religion. Now, in my training to become a leader in this alternative, books played a central role. I was guided by mentors in the American Ethical Union and in the Humanist Institute, and humanism was revealed to me page after page. Life at many ethical societies like here are enriched by book discussions. How many of you have attended a book discussion here at the New York Society? Fair number. The books and the words liberate us from narrow experience. They help us generate wisdom, and it certainly has done so at the two societies where I serve as ethical culture leader. Philadelphia was built on books, certainly. James Logan, who was the mayor of Philadelphia in the late 1700s, established one of the largest lending libraries in the American colonies, and it fed the hungry minds of scientists and scholars who went to Philadelphia to be engaged in intellectual discussion. They converged on the city of brotherly love because it was a leading academic center. One of the most famous was, of course, Benjamin Franklin, who also built his life around books. He was known first and foremost as a printer. This is how he referred to himself in his will. He was also a librarian. In 1731, he founded the Library Company of Philadelphia, which was the first lending library in the United States, with a group that he called the Junto. And Franklin called the Library Company, this is true, he called it, quote, the mother of all North American subscription libraries. Slightly different contemporary term, but that founding group chose a motto that has an almost religious flavor to it. About literacy and wisdom. It was a Latin phrase that translated roughly to support the common good is divine. Now, libraries, I do think, come as close to sacred places for freethinkers and for humanists. Just down the street from the Baltimore Ethical Society is one of the other oldest lending libraries in the United States. It's the Enoch Pratt Library. Enoch Pratt was created in 1886 by the namesake. Enoch Pratt declared, quote, "My library shall be for all, rich or poor, without distinction of race and color, who, when properly accredited, can take out the books if they will handle them carefully and return them." Well, the new branch was created in 1933, and it really feels like a temple to secular and humanist learning. When I visited there last fall, the tall columns in its ceremonial hall sort of lifted my eyes upwards, and I saw high on the building front and side images of these secular saints of circulation, book circulation. On the south wall stands Johann Gutenberg, the creator of movable type. On the north wall, William Caxton, one of the first English printers. And one level down are eight panels of early European publishers posing as the patron saints of printing. All around the room, just under that, are 17 insignias of the great publishing houses of the Western world. Houghton Mifflin, Dutton, Doubleday, Macmillan, Harper, Putnam, Scribner, Oxford, Cambridge, Yale, and Harvard University Presses. And many of them have these symbols that represent wisdom. Two of them have owls in them. Seven of them have trees, like the tree of knowledge. Appleton Publishers has a lovely Latin pun for your Latin scholars. It says, inter folia fructus. Anybody know what that means? Inter folia fructus. Between the leaves, fruit. Leaves, pages, yeah, okay. But the real mecca, I think, for book lovers in this country is the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C., where I live. Now, it's the closest, I think, freethinkers have to a holy site. You can see busloads of tourists unloading there and being shuffled in like going to Chartres or Notre Dame. And its halls are filled with inspirational mosaics and painted and vaulted arches and stained glass. And the first floor of the Great Hall, which acts like a nave of this Italian Renaissance building, has 75-foot ceilings with these incredible sculptures all throughout them in the names of writers and thinkers. And one very interesting set of murals inside that first floor is an evolution of information transfer. The first panel begins with storytellers speaking to a group of nomads. And next to them are the painting of hieroglyphics, and then some individuals, scribes, etching words into stone, and then painted words on animal skins, and then followed by monastic calligraphers with pen and quill on paper. And the last one has the Gutenberg press, perhaps the greatest technological innovation to support humanism ever. Now, up the stairs from that is a huge mosaic of Minerva, the goddess of universal knowledge, that's holding a scroll. I want to show this to you. My wife has worn a scarf I gave to her at Christmas of this. Thank you. If you go up the main stairs, you'll see this, and you'll see the scroll she's holding, Minerva, the goddess of wisdom. And on that scroll are various areas of study: agriculture, poetry, education, mechanics, government, history, astronomy, geography, statistics, economics, and more. Behind that mural is the reading room. How many of you have seen that from the top? Oh, you go to Washington, it is unbelievably gorgeous, like a cathedral. The dome is ringed by bronze statues of 12 men representing in various areas of knowledge. It has Edward Gibbon and Herodotus for history, Columbus and Robert Fulton for commerce, Moses and St. Paul for religion, Michelangelo and Beethoven for art, Francis Bacon and Plato for philosophy, Homer and Shakespeare for poetry, and so on. And far below them are 226 desks, ringing the circulation desk, where these librarians are scurrying around like ants at their task. Now, this is a beautiful cathedral. Let me give this back. Thank you. This scene is from the dome is very different from the original Library of Congress that was housed in the Capitol. It was founded in 1800, burned by the British in 1814, and resurrected greatly due to the generosity of the man who said, quote, "I cannot live without books." Who was that? Jefferson, Thomas Jefferson. He was one of America's most famous Enlightenment thinkers who was said to model his life after the Roman philosopher Cicero. Cicero said, "To add a library to a house is to give a house a soul." That was kind of nice as well. Jefferson spent his life collecting books when he was minister to France. He sent thousands of books back to Monticello. And in 1814, when the British burned 3,000 books in the Library of Congress, Jefferson offered to sell his library to the Congress as a replacement. A year and $23,000 later, the library became the largest collection in the United States with over 6,000 books. And it represented Jefferson's encyclopedic knowledge. It had all different sorts of books, from fiction to science, art and architecture, geography and language, all of which Jefferson believed that a democracy needed in order to flourish. And I'm sure that's why he had also books on beekeeping and beer making. And today, the Library of Congress houses over 150 million items. That's the second most of all of the libraries. Do you know which is the largest in the world? scar? The British Museum, 170 million items. In third place, your very own New York Public Library with 53 million items. The Russian State Library in Moscow is fourth, the National Diet Library in Tokyo is fifth, and the National Library in Beijing, China, is sixth. But of the next 13 on that list, all are from North America and Europe, which testifies to the importance of books in the growth of Western humanism. Now, of course, all over the world there are great libraries that have been collections for different traditions. There are 14,000 stone tablets of Buddhist scriptures that were found in the caves of Yunjin, China. But many of the ancient collections did not make it that far. They didn't survive. The library at Alexandria, which once housed 700,000 papyrus scrolls, didn't survive. It was founded in 228 BCE, and it attracted scholars from all over the Mediterranean world, including the mathematician Euclid. But fires and floods led it to wither away within a couple of centuries after the birth of Christ. Now, some of the fires at Alexandria were sent on purpose, some were accidental. But the ones that were attacked, Romans, Coptics, Muslims, you take your pick, they all like to burn books. They called it biblioclasm, or libricide. It's common in history. I'm going to give you some other examples. In 1893, Muslims sacked India's Nandala University temple, destroyed Buddhist texts there. In Constantinople, just a few years later, the Knights of the Fourth Crusade destroyed the Imperial Library. In 1258, the Mongol invaders sacked Baghdad's House of Worship, throwing books into the Tigris River that purportedly were so many that the ink turned the water black. Now, these attacks continue to today. In 1992, the century-old National Library of Bosnia-Herzegovina was shelled by Serbian troops, attacking Sarajevo, marking the largest single book burning in history. In 1998, the Taliban destroyed 55,000 books and manuscripts at the Bolkhari Library in Afghanistan. In Baghdad again is the victim in 2003, when the Iraq National Library was looted and destroyed. And just last year in Timbuktu, Mali insurgents destroyed manuscripts some over 800 years old. The mayor of Timbuktu was so distraught, he wailed, "This is terrible news. By destroying them, they threaten the world." Now, the reality is that it is heaven and not this world that often leads to the destruction of books. In 1499, during the Spanish Inquisition, Cardinal Cisneros burned books that focused on humans rather than God. In 1562, the Spanish friars were so frustrated at their inability to convert some of the indigenous that they burned all samples of Mayan writing they could find. And civilization was denied access to priceless Mayan history, astronomical data, calendars, and the self-satisfied Bishop Delandia gleefully reported back to Rome that what was destroyed, quote, contained nothing in which were not to be seen as superstition and lies of the devil. So religious intolerance is the most common cause of book burning, and the bonfires are harbingers for even greater evil. In writing about the burning of the Muslim holy book, the Quran, Heinrich Heine in 1821 noted that ink and blood run together. He said, "Where they burn books, so too they will in the end burn human beings." And certainly that was the case in the Holocaust, when fascists saw very little difference between the destruction of literature and genocide. The German regime destroyed words and human beings in bonfires and bombings and death camp furnaces. And even the Allied bombings made little distinction between books and bodies. Franklin Delano Roosevelt noted the irony of how often words fared better than people. He spoke to the booksellers of America and said, "Books cannot be killed by fire. People die, but books never die. No man and no force can abolish memory." And it's really amazing how often words will come back after being repressed over and over and over. Despite the forces of terror, they keep coming back. Often, in fact, the repression backfires, right? I mean, the best way to get your book to sell big is to ban it. The Catholic Church figured that out. They had been publishing an index of banned books, and they did it for many years until they found out people were getting the indexes so they could go find the books. And they stopped doing it. Solomon Rushdie's book, Satanic Verses, was just selling a couple of hundred books a week until the fatwa, and then it grew to 750,000, like that. Now, it was the flames of World War II that inspired author Ray Bradbury to write Fahrenheit 451, which is the approximate degree of temperature that books burn at. Bradbury said, "It follows then that Hitler burned a book I felt as keenly, please forgive me, as he was killing a human. For in the long sum of history, they are one and the same flesh." Maybe that's too far. But books were fundamental to how Bradbury saw the world. According to an official biographer, one of the very last essays Bradbury wrote was a childhood memory that I want to share. "When I was 7 years old, I started going to the library and I took out 10 books a week. The librarian looked at me and said, 'What are you doing?' I said, 'What do you mean?' And she said, 'You can't possibly read all of those books before they're due back.' I said, 'Yes, I can.' And I came back the next week for 10 more books. And in doing so, I told that librarian politely to get out of my way and let me be. Let me happen. That's what books do. They're building blocks, the DNA, if you will, of you." He continues, "Think of everything that you have read, everything you've ever learned by holding a book in your hands, how that knowledge shaped you, made you who you are today. Looking back now on all those years to when I first discovered books at the library, I see that I was simply falling in love with books. Day after day, after glorious day, I was falling in love with books." One veteran of the brutality of World War II praised libraries. General Eisenhower said, "Don't join the book burners. Don't think you're going to conceal faults by concealing evidence that they ever existed. Don't be afraid to go to your library and read every book." Now, America had its own intolerance towards books ourselves. It wasn't just overseas. Anthony Comstock, in 1873, founded the Society for the Suppression of Vice, whose seal actually has a picture of book burning. I'll pass these around. He was very proud of this. This organization, again, called the Society for Suppressing Vice, Comstock was very proud to claim that he had destroyed 15 tons of lewd books. Lewd, according to Anthony Comstock. Robert Ingersoll, who was one of Comstock's greatest adversaries, warned that censorship was dangerous to both democracy and humanism. He saw an unholy alliance between intolerance and fundamentalism, and Ingersoll attacked both of them ferociously. He said, "Give me the storm and tempest of thought and action rather than the dead calm of ignorance and faith. Banish me from Eden, if you will, but let me eat the fruit of the tree of knowledge." Ingersoll saw biblical depictions of knowledge as the source of hubris and sin and corruption, as the church would like us to see it. And the church used that idea that knowledge was sinful to control through intimidation and ignorance. And it goes all the way back to the Garden of Eden and how that was used. The faithful might tell us that there, the tree of knowledge grew delicious forbidden fruits, and when the devil incarnated as a snake was able to manipulate Eve and Adam, it marks the fall of man and woman. Unable to resist, human beings chose knowledge over submission to God. Thus arises this cultural condemnation of the human quest for wisdom. An odd response to me. So it's no wonder that religious intolerance and piety are so often wrapped up in attacks on books and libraries and wisdom. These were the things that drove us from the Garden of Eden, from paradise. But for humanists and free thinkers and lovers of arts and literature, there are few things more noble than nurturing the written word. It's precisely because the Garden of Eden, the Garden of Wisdom, calls to us and brings out our best. Our Argentinian writer Jorge Luis Borges put it this way. He said, "I have always imagined paradise as a kind of library." Humanism has always placed its faith in human beings and their insatiable appetite for knowledge and wisdom. And the Renaissance brought forth universities everywhere that renewed this commitment to wisdom as tied to the creation of ethical, responsible human beings. Scholars embrace new works and discoveries. Erasmus, who's known as one of the most important humanists of all, used books to advance society. Rhetoric and moral philosophy began to be taught and embraced as tools for good governance. And in the arts, human beings began to be portrayed more realistically and of central concern, endowed with greater hope and responsibility for building the world. And man became the measure of all things. Discoveries in science and optics and mapping turned humans' attention from the vertical to the horizontal. Books began to fill the libraries of traders and merchants and scholars, and it was the furnace, really, of our modern world. Gutenberg's press accelerated this process by making the written word available to many more people at less of a price. No longer dependent on monastic scribes, free thinkers began to spread their message. The Enlightenment accelerated book learning, and the public became more literate. Works were printed in local dialects rather than just Latin, and libraries began to flourish. Louis XVI was very proud when he began his Lyon Public Library, which had 55,000 volumes. Diderot began his, quote, systemic dictionary of the sciences, arts, and crafts, otherwise known as the Encyclopedia. This was published in France between 1751 and 1772, and it contained 28 volumes with 71,000 articles. Intended, in the manuscript listed, intended, quote, to change the way people think. So this grand project had a lot of radical anti-authoritarian things, and it posed a problem for Louis XVI, because it was a jewel in France's intellectual crown, but it had some subversive elements, because it promoted free thought and wisdom, freedom of conscience, and included individual religious sovereignty. The church no longer had a monopoly. The writer Dumouriez said, quote, "Reason is to the philosopher what grace is to the Christian. Other men walk in darkness. The philosopher who has the same passions acts only after reflection. He walks through the night, but is preceded by a torch." So the age of revolution and the age of American democracy was infused with Enlightenment and humanist values. Thomas Paine's The Age of Reason, which was published in 1793, advocated free thought and reason as sounder guides for fledgling democracy than traditional religion. And for this, he was slandered, arrested, and nearly executed. He died a marginalized figure with an obituary that pleased many of his critics. It wasn't written by him. It said, he lived long, did some good and much harm. He was perhaps the first martyr to American humanism. Now, the first widespread use of the term humanism was noted around 1800, and it meant this narrow bundle of academic subjects, including grammar and rhetoric and poetry and history and moral philosophy, which praised human nature and exalted this world, the one we live in. It emphasized the obligation of people to be educated and active citizens, informed by books and by laws. One of the murals of the Library of Congress emphasized the importance of books and wisdom to democracy. It has a picture, it's called Anarchy. It has a picture of buildings crumbling and rubble crushing books on the ground, and a figure is stepping on manuscripts and holds a burning book in their hand. And it says, this is what happens to a democracy that forgets about books. That's the fate of civilization without respect for the written word. Prior to the Civil War, Horace Mann, the leader of the Common School Movement, planted seeds of national education in our country. We had agricultural sciences growing, the growth of land-grant colleges across the country, many books and journals about science and articles were being published all over. One of the most famous was called The Truth Seeker Journal, published by D.M. Bennett. And on the masthead of the first edition in 1873, around the time ethical culture began, it said that it was devoted to science, morals, free thought, free discussions, liberalism, sexual equality, labor reform, progression, free education, and whatever tends to elevate and emancipate the human race. Good things. Today that would be good, yeah. Let alone 1873. The Truth Seeker was fond of Felix Adler's words and had published a lot of his speeches in it. You also had various heathen contributors like Clarence Darrow and Mark Twain and Elizabeth Cady Stanton. Margaret Sanger published in the Truth Seeker Journal. And they echoed the values of Voltaire and Thomas Paine and Jefferson. And it wasn't long between Comstock was calling for Bennett's head. And this is a very huge splash in the press these days. Bennett was nicknamed by his critics the devil's own advocate. He liked that, actually. He spent almost all of his time and money fighting in courts against these attacks. He ended up serving 13 months in a federal penitentiary for obscenity and got very ill and died younger. He was a second big martyr for humanism in the United States. Nevertheless, the freethinker kept selling and grew in the 1880s and 90s. If you want to know more about that, there's a new video called Liberty, American Free Thought, produced by Roderick Bradford. I have a paper if you're interested. It was made in conjunction with the Council for Secular Humanism. In 1895, Elizabeth Cady Stanton published one of the boldest books ever. It was The Woman's Bible. And she experienced similar attacks by conservative critics. She hoped to liberate women from the subservient role that many interpreters of the Bible had been pushing down people's throats. It was instantly a classic and a bestseller, but it also led her to be condemned and marginalized, not only by conservative critics, but unfortunately by the more moderate progressive suffragettes of the suffrage association. Now, it was around the same time that a modern robber baron did more for American humanism than virtually anybody else, Andrew Carnegie, who donated $350 million to build public libraries. It's the equivalent of $4.2 billion today. He said, "There is not such a cradle of democracy upon the earth as the free public library. This republic of letters where neither rank, office, nor wealth receive the slightest consideration." There are always going to be book burners and censors, and they're going to meddle in our libraries and our mail, and they're now reading our cyber messages. And these intrusions on our privacy need to be fought, but we have to be vigilant and protest such intrusions. I want to finish, though, today, because I think we all agree on that, with a second challenge to the importance of words and the roots of humanism. And that is how difficult it is to really be open to a diversity of ideas, especially when we have to handle this flood of information. We have so much information. In order to really be open to a diversity of thought, my personal biggest challenge is not that I can't get the books, it's that I don't have the time to read them, and I don't have the energy to read books that I know I'm not going to agree with. So it's not censors that really are my problem, it's an internal censor. It takes more work for me to read people that I know I'm going to disagree with. But if we're going to strive to be open, if we're really going to honor humanism, we have to be willing to do that, to take all perspectives, and to teach our children to do the same, which might be the hardest thing to do. Are we willing to let our young people read books we don't agree with across a wide variety of spectrums, whether it's socialist or libertarian or atheist, or non-theist, or theist? That's what our new AU Ethical Education Director believes. Dale McGowan, who just came on board, advocates in Parenting Beyond Belief that we do that, because he wanted his children to think for themselves, not just to think like he did. So he encouraged them to read all sorts of books. It's also one of my favorite freethinkers, Daniel Dennett, also advocates that. A couple of years ago, he wrote a great book I recommended called Breaking the Spell. And in it, Dennett argued for compulsory education in religion. Now, what's an atheist freethinker advocating that for? Well, I want to read some more of his book to tell you. He says, let's get more education about religion in the schools, not less. We should teach our children creeds and customs, prohibitions, and rituals, texts, and music. And when we cover the history of the religion, we should include the positive, the role of the church in the civil rights movement, the flourishing of science and arts in early Islam, the role of black Muslims in bringing hope, honor, and self-respect to otherwise shattered lives and are meant for many of our inmates in our prisons, for instance, and the negatives, the Inquisition, anti-Semitism through history, the role of the Catholic Church in spreading AIDS because they are resisting the distribution of condoms. He continues, no religion should be favored and none ignored. He said, the devout of all faiths should face the challenge of making sure that their creed is worthy enough, attractive and plausible and meaningful enough to withstand the temptations of its competitors. If you have to hoodwink or blindfold your children to ensure that they'll confirm your faith, then when they are adults, your faith ought to go extinct. That's a humanist position. In an interview, he continued, he said, we need to let our children grow up to face the world armed with knowledge, with much more knowledge than we ourselves had at their age. It's scary, but the alternative is worse. I think that's at the heart of the humanist tradition. It's certainly at our roots. To take in a wide variety of information, to try to read many words and hear many stories and work through them to come to some sort of common understanding and path forward in this world based on evidence and openness and tolerance. If we're going to honor the tree of knowledge, grown only because of the commitment of thousands of people who came before us, we have to taste many different fruits of the tree of knowledge. Variety of mental food, if you will, is precisely that makes us strong. John Kennedy said, libraries should be open to all except the censor. We must know all the facts, hear all the alternatives, and listen to all criticism. Let us welcome controversial books and controversial authors, for the Bill of Rights is our guardian and our security of our liberty as well. If we're to be enlightened citizens, we have to commit to a broad commitment to read the written word from all sources, and our democracy depends on it. I know for me, in our information-rich age with so much to read, I can avoid what I don't like. I can watch The Daily Show. But in order to be strong, we have to keep many books on our tree of knowledge. We have to be committed to that. We have to be true to our humanist and free thought traditions and to honor what the Renaissance and the Enlightenment gave to us. We have to honor our humanist roots, and only then will the book burners not win. Thank you very much. Thank you.